अस्सलाम वालेकुम डियर स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस लिटरेचर एंड लिटरेरी स्टडीज़। सो इन टुडेज़ लेक्चर वी विल डिस्कस लिटरेरी स्टडीज़। व्हाट इज़ द डिफरेंस बिटवीन लिटरेचर एंड लिटरेरी स्टडी, लिटरेचर वर्सेस लिटरेरी स्टडीज़, व्हाट इज़ लिटरेरी थ्योरी, ट्रेडिशनल लिटरेरी क्रिटिसिज्म, फॉर्मलिज्म एंड न्यू क्रिटिसिज्म, मार्क्सिज्म एंड क्रिटिकल थ्योरी, स्ट्रक्चरलिज्म एंड पोस्ट स्ट्रक्चरलिज्म, न्यू हिस्टोरिसिज्म एंड कल्चरल मटेरियलिज्म। डियर स्टूडेंट, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वील डील विद लिटरेरी स्टडीज। लिटरेरी स्टडीज इज द स्टडी ऑफ रिटन वर्क्स ऑफ द इमेजिनेशन ऑफ विच पोएट्री, ड्रामा एंड नैरेटिव फिक्शन कॉन्स्टिट्यूट टूडे द मोस्ट फेमिलियर टाइप्स ऑफ जेनर्स। Most students and teachers of literature, however, see it as a more complex matter. It might be more accurate to describe it as a set of methods for examining the richness and diversity of experience through unusual uses of language, through a language that we recognize as different from everyday language and that thereby aspires to produce a reflection of and on the world not available to us otherwise. As such, literary works are also primary documents for investigating national histories, world events, the individual psyche, race, class, gender, science, economics, religion, the natural world, layer and the other arts. Because literary studies engage with countless other disciplines, it is among the most interdisciplinary of any field of the study. So now we'll deal with what is the difference between literature and literary studies. While literature is an art, obviously we all know that to perform it, you have to be artistically talented. Literary study is a social sciences and you need to study it. It's very beautifully explained that while literature is an art and to perform it, you have to be artistically talented. Literary studies is a social sciences and you need to study it. The first one does not necessarily require education, but the latter one requires a great command of literary texts, genres, and most important of all, literary theory. Thus, at least an undergraduate degree, of course, you must also have a wide perspective and a great love for reading. So now we'll discuss Literature versus Literary Studies by David Lane. So it's a review type given by David Lane about literature and literary studies. The State of English Department has been on my mind of late, so I am interested that the new issue of review devotes three long articles to the topic, what is literary studies. That alone suggests that my perception that something amiss is widespread. No doubt the timing also has to do with the modern language. Association meetings opening later this week in San Francisco. And how did I fail to work up some scam to be there rather than central between Christmas and the New Year? So I am not going to spend a lot of time here, at least not now, bewailing how literature is taught on how curricula are structured. More immediately interesting for the sake of the KR blog is the growing paradox that writing of literature, or at least the attempt to do so, is thriving as never before, both in undergraduate and graduate institutions. The point is that students of all ages and the KR Young Writers program is evidence as well do still care about literature. They love it. They read it. they want to write it and be part of the ever more healthy community of writers and readers. I don't think this is just misguided narcissism or large fraud perpetrated by MFA administrator. These students' rights and certainly those who teach them are well aware of market realities. They know putting pen to paper or digit to keyboard is not any way to get rich or famous. The odds are far better with lotteries and lightning strikes. There is a kind of altruism at the heart of the that may well be native, but I find quite moving. A further irony, as commercial publishing is collapsing at about the same speed as the Madoff Ponzi scheme, the hundreds of literary magazines in print and increasingly online are finding audiences. They may be small, have always been, but people are reading, submitting, participating. The literary community is thriving as never before. Readers in the future may well be a relatively small niche of an infinitely fragmented population, but I am convinced more than ever that they will never disappear altogether, no matter how the media change that provides story, poems, and essays. Now back to the classroom. I am increasingly of the mind that English departments are playing a desperate game of emperor's clothes. No, that's not it. More like pay no attention to the phony wizard behind the curtain. In today's academy, no single literary curriculum has any real coherence. Each department has its rationale, of course, its requirements for major to fulfill, but it all seems a shame, a way of doing the reality that there's no substantial underlying coherence or agreement. I don't need to get into name calling about political correctness or academic fashion or theory bashing. It's just that few literature teachers, myself included, really agree any longer on what we are trying to do or why. I am not for a moment saying we should try resuscitate a great books curriculum or purely Western canon from the 1960 or 70, that would be preposterous even if it were possible. Nor am I suggesting that opening the curriculum to authors and texts from the other culture or classes has been wrong-headed. Far from it, we have all been greatly enriched. The problem is that we lack any agreement on how to talk about any of that literature, and so each teacher and professor tends to go about it according to personal druthers in the privacy of a classroom. My sense is that students are increasingly aware that something is lacking. Statistically, certainly show a strong falling off undergraduates seeking English major, especially among men, and I don't think that's entirely because of rotten economy. I am not sure that were I 18 or 19 today, I had choose to pursue an English major again. Years ago, in my first year in college, good Lord, now I am sounding like the ancient of days. I was surrounded by and taught by people who do not only believed in the singular importance of literature and literary study. They were unbiased in their passion, studying, reading, arguing, caring was not about righting political wrongs, nor about any other particular use. Literature mattered in some deeper ways. That was resonant with Holyright. Maybe that was just the last vestige of modernism or romanticism, but the passion communicated itself. Certainly, I loved the novels and poems before I went to college, but only there was I struck by the lightning of how special it would be to devote myself that literature was a cause, an end in itself, almost a blessing, that was communicated to me by the professor who taught. And what mattered was their attitude, not the particular curriculum of that moment. We were not most of us who are teaching today inspired like that. Well, I think few of us communicate any similar passion to students very well these days. We had far too embraced. So, dear students, that was a review we have discussed here by David Lane, Literature versus Literary Studies. So, I think so it will be very useful for your exams too. So now we'll discuss literary theory. Literary theory is the body of ideas and methods we use in the practical reading of literature. By literary theory, we refer not to the meaning of a work of literature, but to the theories that reveal why what literature can mean. Literary theory is a description of the underlying principles, one might say the tools, by which we attempt to understand literature. All literary interpretation draws on a basis in theory but can serve as justification for very different kinds of critical activity. It is literary theory that formulates the relationship between author and work. Basically, this is the thing that he is saying, that it is literary theory that formulates the relationship between author and work. So literary theory develops the significance of race, class and gender for literary study, both from the standpoint of the biography of the author and an analysis of their thematic presence within the text. Literary theory offers varying approaches for understanding the role of historical context in interpretation, as well as the relevance of linguistic and unconscious elements of the text. Literary theorists trace the history and evolution of the different genres, narrative, dramatic, lyric, in addition to the more recent emergence of the novel and the short story, while also investigating the importance of formal elements of literary structure. Lastly, literary theory in recent years has sought to explain the degree to which the text is more the product of culture than individual author, in turn how those texts help to create the culture. So now, what is literary theory? Literary theory, sometimes designated critical theory or theory, and now undergoing a transformation into cultural theory within the discipline of literary studies, can be understood as the set of concepts and intellectual assumption on which rests the work of explaining or interpreting literary texts. Literary theory refers to any principle derived from internal analysis of literary texts or from knowledge external to the text that can be applied in the multiple interruptive situations. All critical practice regarding literature depends on an underlying structure of ideas in at least two ways. Theory provides a rationale for what constitutes the subject matter of criticism, the literary and the specific aims of critical practice, the act of interpretation itself. For example, to speak of the unity of the Oedipus, the king explicitly invokes Aristotle's theoretical statement on poetics. To argue, as does that Joseph Conrad, the heart of darkness, fails to grant full humanity to the Africans it depicts is a perspective informed by a post-colonial literary theory that presupposes a history of exploitation and racism. Critics that explain the climatic drawing of Edna in the Waking as a suicide generally call upon a sporting architecture of feminist and gender theory, the structure of ideas that enables criticism of literary work may or may not be acknowledged by the critic. And the status of literary theory within the academic discipline of literary studies continues to evolve. Literary theory and the formal practice of literary interpretation runs a parallel but less well-known course within the history of philosophy and is evident in the historical record at least as far back as Plato. The Cartels contains a Plato's meditation on the relationship of words and the things to which they refer, Plato's skepticism about signification that words bear no etymological relationship to their meaning but are arbitrarily imposed becomes a central concern in the 20th century to both structuralism and post-structuralism. However, a persistent belief in reference, the notion that words and images refer to an objective reality, has provided epistemological, that is, having to do with theories of knowledge, support for theories of literary representation throughout most of Western history until the 19th century. Art, in Shakespeare's phrase, held a mirror up to the nature and faithfully recorded an objectively real world independent of the observer. Literature is not history representing facts of life with the truth and accuracy, so that men of later generations can acquire their knowledge of the past times by the study of the literature of the times. Though literature and life are vitally linked up, mere photographic representation of life does not constitute true literature. The creative artist shares his intellectual pleasures with the readers through his artistic or imaginative presentment of the life that has moved him to his depth of feeling and thought. The word of imagination is often wrongly supposed to be one of mere abstraction or shadows, which have little to do with life or reality, but is a world conjured up by the imagination of the artist out of the crude mass of reality and presented with the true proportion of and sense of beauty. Modern literary theory gradually emerged in Europe during the 19th century. In one of the earliest development of literary theory, German higher criticism subject biblical text to the radical historicizing that broke with the traditional scriptural interpretation. Higher or source criticism analyzed biblical tales in a light of comparable narratives from other culture, an approach that anticipated some of the method and spirit of 20th century theory, particularly structuralism and new historicism in France. The eminent literary critic Charles Augustin Saint maintained that a work of literature could be explained entirely in terms of biography, while novelist Michael Proust devoted his life to the refuting Saint in a massive narrative, which he contended that the details of the life of the artist are utterly transformed in the work of art. This dispute was taken up anew by the French theorist Ronald Barthes in his famous Declaration of the Death of the Author. See Structuralism and Post-Structuralism. Perhaps the greatest 19th century influence on literary theory came from the deep epistemological suspicion of Friedrich, that facts are not fact until they have been interpreted. Critique of knowledge has had a profound impact on literary studies and helped usher in an era of intense literary theorizing that has yet to pass. So now we'll deal with traditional literary criticism. Academic literary criticism prior to the rise of new criticism in the United States tended to practice traditional literary history, tracking influence, establishing the canon of major writers in the literary periods, and clarifying historical context and allusions. Within the text, literary biography was and still is an important interpretive method in and out of the academy. Variants of moral criticism not unlike the Lewes school in Britain and aesthetic. Criticism were also generally influential literary practices. Perhaps the key unifying feature of traditional literary criticism was the consensus with the academy as to the both of literary canon and the aims and purpose of literature. So that is the book all educated persons should read. That is a reference. What literature was and why we read literature, and what we read were question that subsequent movements in literary theory were to raise. Formalism and new criticism. Formalism is the name, implies an interpretive approach that emphasizes literary form and the study of literary devices within the text. The work of the formalist had a general impact on later developments in structuralism and other authors of narrative formalism like structuralism sought to place the study of literature on a scientific basis through objective analysis of the motives, devices, techniques, and other functions that comprise the literary work. The formalists placed great importance on the literariness of texts, those qualities that distinguished the literary form other kinds of writing. Neither author nor context was essential for the formalist. It was the narrative that spoke the hero function, for example, that had meaning. Form was the content. A plot device or narrative strategy was examined for how it functioned and compared to how it had functioned in other literary works. Of the Russian formalist critics, Roman and Victor, probably the most well-known. So, now we'll deal with Marxism and critical theory. Marxist literary theories tend to focus on the representation of class conflict as well as the reinforcement of class distinctions through the medium of literature. Marxist theorists use traditional techniques of literary analysis but subordinate aesthetic concern to the final social and political meaning of literature. Marxist theorists often champion authors sympathetic to the working class and authors whose work challenges economic equalities found in capitalist societies. In keeping with the totalizing spirit of Marxism, literary theory arising from the Marxists have not only sought new ways of understanding the relationship between economic production of literature but all cultural production as well. Marxist analysis of the society and history have had a profound effect on the literary theory and practical criticism, most notably in the development of the new historicism and new cultural materialism. So, structuralism and post-structuralism.
Like the new criticism, structuralism sought to bring to literary studies a set of objective criteria for analysis and intellectual rigor. Structuralism can be viewed as an extension of formalism, in that the both structuralism and formalism devoted their attention to matters of literary forms, for example structure, rather than social or historical content, and that both bodies of thought were intending to put the study of literature on a scientific objective basis. Structuralism relied initially on the ideas of the Swiss linguist Ferdinand de Saussure. Like Plato, Saussure regarded the signifier works, marks, symbols as arbitrary and unrelated to the concept of the signified, which it referred within the way a particular society uses language and signs. Meaning was constituted by a system of differences between units of the language. Particular meanings were of less interest than the underlying structures of signification that made meaning itself possible, often expressed as an emphasis of language rather than parole. So, lang and parole. New historicism and cultural materialism. New historicism, a term coined by Stephen Greenblatt, designates a body of theoretical and interpretive practices that began largely with the study of early modern literature in the United States. New historicism and American had been somewhat anticipated by the theorist of cultural materialism in Britain, which in the words of their leading advocate, Raymond Williams, describes the analysis of all forms of signification, including quite centrally writing within the actual means and condition of their production. Both new historicism and cultural materialism seeks to understand literary texts historically and reject the formalizing influence of previous literary studies, including new criticism, structuralism, and deconstruction, all of which in varying ways privilege the literary text and place only secondary emphasis on historical and social context. According to new historicism, the circulation of literary and non-literary texts produce relationships of social power within a culture. New historicism that differs from traditional historicism in literary studies in a several crucial ways. Rejecting traditional historicism, premise of neutral inquiry. New historicism accepts the necessity of making historical value judgment. According to new historicism, we can only know the textual history of the past because it is embedded. A key term in the textually of the present, and it concerns text and context are less clearly distinct in new history practice. Traditional separation of literary and non-literary texts, great literature and popular literature are also fundamentally challenged for the new historicists. All acts of expression are embedded in the material conditions of a culture. Texts are examined with an eye for how they reveal the economic and social realities, especially as they produce ideology and represent power or subversion, like much of the emergent European social history of the 1980s. New historicism takes particular interest in representation of marginalized group and non-normative behaviors which crafts cross-dressing, present revolts and exorcism as exemplary of the need for power to represent subversive alternatives, the other to legitimate itself. So new historicism thought differ from the traditional historicism in the literary studies in several crucial ways. So this is the thing that we are dealing with, the new historicism and cultural materialism. So new historicism is a term obviously that is coined by Stephen Greenblatt, but new historicist thought differs from traditional historicism. This is the thing that we have to deal with it. So with this we'll conclude today's lecture. So inshallah, see you next. So take care and stay home. Thank you. Allah Hafiz.